I now call upon Ms. Aisha, who will be introducing the speaker and welcoming Ms. Hiba for the session. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Shinna and Mr. Ben, for the great introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. Hope you're doing great. First of all, I would like to thank you all for taking out your busy schedule and attending the session. We'll start with some housekeeping rules for the smooth functioning of our webinar today. Kindly refrain from switching on your mics throughout this presentation. Post all your questions in the chat box. We will be answered at the end of the session. It's with a great pleasure I welcome our guest of the honor for the day and our speaker, Ms. Hiba Aijaz. Ms. Hiba is our eminent alumni, completed mechanical engineering from University of Bolton in 2012. After graduation, she started working as a specification consultant, and since then, she didn't have to look back in her career. Climbing up her career ladder, she's currently working as the specification manager for Saint-Gobain UAE, in close ties with manufacturing firms, specification numerous building materials used in the construction industry. She works in the with the architects and engineering consultant in the region, supporting them in the design and planning phase of construction sector. Her key is her contribution were in projects like Address JBR, Mediclinic Hospital, GEM Schools, and Dubai Expo Pavilion. I wholeheartedly welcome Ms. Hiba Aijaz on behalf of University of Bolton Rock Academy Center to start our first talk of University of Bolton Rock Web Senior Series. Now I will hand over Ms. Hiba Aijaz. Thank you.
Hello. Good morning, everyone. I hope I'm clear to everybody. And it would be a more audible and easy, comfortable seminar if we have our microphones on mute. So I would like to request you to kindly put your mics on mute. So thank you very much, Aisha, for the introduction, Ma'am Shimna and Ben for arranging the seminar, and all the other respected bodies who were also who have also come together in putting this together. I just have a small request. If I'm removed as a co-host, I may not get the notifications of the people joining. So perhaps Mr. Ben, if you can remove me from being the co-host. Yeah.
Yes, I will.
Okay, so the topic of today's seminar is internal building materials in the construction industry. And this is very closely related to my field. And when I was a student in University of Bolton, one of the modules that I was studying was advanced building materials and structures. So at that time, as a student, it's we are very curious to know and intrigued to know how we are going to apply this knowledge into our career and how it is going to be used in our professional life. This is one of the questions that my fellow batch members and myself used to often discuss, that every time we would start a new module or a topic, we would always go back to, so in what field can we actually apply the principles that we are studying in this module? So I'm hoping that this seminar will answer the question for some of you students, that when you're studying internal building materials, where exactly can you apply it? So I'll start with the session. Okay. The agenda would be a very brief introduction of the company Saint-Gobain. We are not going to spend a lot of time here. It's just to lay the foundation of where our research is coming from and the content that's going to follow in the presentation. What are the basis of that content? We are going to talk about sustainability in the UAE, what the UAE government and regulations are doing in order to create more sustainable facilities as we head into the future, and indoor comfort. So indoor comfort is going to be a large part of this presentation, as we are going to discuss how internal building materials can provide indoor comfort to the end users of a particular building facility. I would really like to hear questions from you. So please, whatever question you have, put that in the chat box, and Mr. Ben will be taking note of those. Towards the end of the session, we'll be having a question and answer session. And remember, no question is stupid. This is the time when you can ask whatever questions you have, and it will not seem stupid. But 5 or 6 years down the line, when you're into your career or when you're having an exam, and if that's the point you're having this question, then it might be too late. So this is the platform. If you have any questions, keep them in the chat box and we will look at them later. So briefly, who we are. So I'm representing Saint-Gobain, the company that I work for. And this company is actually 350 years old. And it started off as glass manufacturing firm in France. So since then, it has been constantly developing and innovating different building materials for the construction industry. So there's a lot of experience in the group with regards to the construction materials and building materials. It is present in 68 countries. So every different region has a specific solution, a specialized solution for their specific region. So like I said, it's constantly innovating. We have R&D departments across the world, and two of our R&D departments are also in the UAE in Abu Dhabi. So this company is also having a lot of building material solutions under its umbrella. As you can see, I have put the brand names on the screen. So there are a lot of building material companies within Saint-Gobain, and what the department that I am part of looks after the building materials that form the internal part of the building. So we have a separate department that deals with the external envelope and the facade of the building. So and I'm from the department that looks after the building materials that are used inside the building. So these are the building materials very briefly. We are going to go into more details of each of them. So there is Saint-Gobain glass, so internal glass. Whenever we are working for a facility and we have a requirement of glass, it's important to look into some of its performance requirements before the architects or civil engineers or they decide what kind of glass is going to be used. So we are going to look into some of those aspects. Then gypsum. Gypsum is one of the key materials that forms the aesthetics of the internal building environment. So we are going to look into some aspects of that. And then we have ceilings. So what kind of ceilings are formed in an internal building environment? We have a lot of, from Weber, the company Weber has a lot of mortar-based construction solutions. So this includes renders, what kind of screed, cementitious solutions, waterproofing solutions. So we're going to look into more details of that. We also have fire-resistant glass solutions from Vetrotech and insulation. So glass fiber, and stone mineral wool insulation. This is just a brief introduction. Of course, we are going to go into more details and it's going to get more clear as we move along. So whenever a building is being designed, a construction facility is being designed, there are two aspects that a responsible architectural firm or a responsible client has to take into account. So the first factor is the comfort of the end user. So whoever is going to be using the facility. So for example, if it is a hotel, then it's going to be the hotel guests who are going to be using the facility. If it is a hospital, then it's the doctors, the patients, the medical staff who's going to be using the facility. If it's a school, then it's going to be the students and the teachers. So you get the gist. The facility has to be designed so that it is comfortable and convenient to be used by the end user. That's the basic principle that that all stakeholders in the construction industry should work to. There are also government regulations that provide information to the construction industry stakeholders on how to make a facility more comfortable for the end user. So we have that in the coming sections. The second aspect is the sustainability of that building facility. So 20, 30 years back, this concept was still new, but specifically in the UAE, in the last 10 to 15 years, sustainability is one of the crucial requirements in a building facility or in any other industry. Sustainability is being given importance because a lot of research that has been coming in from the scientists around the world about the global warming, I'm sure you're all well aware of it. So sustainability is one of the important factor that has to be looked into when designing a facility. So these are the two criteria. Let's look at sustainability first, and then we are going to go into the comfort, indoor comfort. So I have put some facts and figures here of the environmental impact that buildings have in the UAE. So as you can see on the screen, 80% of all electricity produced in GCC countries is for the building industry. 60% for AC only out of this. 60 out of the 80%, 60% is for the AC and rest is for the other activities. The construction industry is also notorious for generating 40% of solid waste. So that's a huge amount. And the issue with generating with so much waste is where to deposit it, what kind of landfill sites, or where do we deposit this waste that is generated. And then 20% of the water consumption is contributed to the building industry. And also it is contributing to 30% of greenhouse gas emissions. So those are actually big figures that are impacting on our environment. In the UAE, there are numerous authorities that are developing some regulations in order to ensure that we are not negatively impacting the environment. So we have ST Dama in Abu Dhabi, part of the Masdar organization. Then in Dubai, there is Al Safat guidelines, which are green building guidelines that construction stakeholders are required to follow in order to achieve minimum sustainability requirements. Or they can enhance if they want to appear as a more sustainable client, they can always enhance. I'm sure a lot of you would be doing LEED as well. So it's an international body, and there are different ratings. You can either have a platinum LEED certification, which is the highest, then you can have a gold LEED certification, silver or bronze. Most of the pavilions and the Expo Dubai are required to meet the highest LEED criteria, because that's the image that UAE wants to portray in front of the world, that we are moving towards a sustainable economy. And one of the other aspects is that in UAE, the governments and regulations are encouraging circular economy. A circular economy simply means that whatever is the waste that is being generated gets to be recycled, so that the building material is always in that cycle. I have put this life cycle approach analysis on the screen, which basically means from the time a building material is just a raw material, which has to undergo the manufacturing process. Basically, we are required to study what happens when it is being manufactured, during the logistics stage, during the installation stage, building lifetime, end of life, and then recycling. So if a building material is following all these processes in a correct manner, then and it is being recycled back again to the factory as a raw material, then this is what a circular economy basically means, that the material that's going into the factory, it undergoes manufacturing, it serves its purpose, it gets used as a product into a building facility, and then at the end of its life, it gets recycled and goes back into the factory. So that is basically circular economy. During these different stages of manufacturing, logistics, and installation, it is important to also understand the carbon footprint. What kind of carbon emissions is that particular raw material causing at each stage? So this is also studied by third-party organizations around the world. And if these kind of analyses are conducted for a particular building material, then that building material is offered and offered a certification. So in Saint-Gobain, our building materials are studied throughout their life cycle in order to get this third-party certification. If you want to know more about the certification, we can discuss that at we can discuss that separately. I will move on now to the comfort section. And in the comfort section, what I want to list is how an end user for which for whom the building facility is being designed, how the comforts in a building environment is impacting their work and their efficiency. And in the later sections, you will see how building materials are responsible for offering this kind of comfort. So for example, if there are some studies that, we have contributed to, you can see them in the top right corner. So basically, Saint-Gobain has participated and contributed to these studies. These are related to health and well-being and productivity in offices. How can we enhance efficiency in a commercial environment? And then on the left, you have some facts and figures that if you have more outside views, so if you're using more glass as a building material, then you're getting more outside views, which will offer you a higher mental function and memory function. So it will improve it by around 25%. Then the hospital stays with more use of glass. So the more glass you use, more outside views you have, the hospital stays will be 8.5% shorter. So these studies are directly showing how different building materials are impacting the comfort of the end user in a building. Some other facts and figures are given that with better systems, with better daylight, what kind of efficiency and optimization can be achieved. I'll move on now to the comforts that we have been talking about. In today's seminar, I'll be looking into acoustic, fire, indoor air quality, hygiene, moisture management, robustness and durability, and aesthetic. So we'll be looking at how building materials can come together to provide optimum acoustics to a building facility, optimum fire and life safety requirements to a facility, and indoor air quality, how the internal building materials can improve indoor air quality, hygiene. So in healthcare environments, how hygiene can be improved, moisture management, and robust and durability. So I'll start with acoustics. Now, in order to determine the right level of acoustics in a particular building facility, there is a field of acoustic engineering. So people who are doing electronic engineering, electric engineering, or mechanical engineering even have an option to further enhance their career into the field of acoustic engineering. What acoustic engineers do, they have certain softwares, they have sensors, they use these software sensors and modeling in order to understand how to obtain comfortable levels of acoustics in a facility. So for example, if we are looking at a hotel guest room, then the noise transmission between one guest room to another is not the same as the sound transmission that you need between two cinemas. So a cinema, of course, has more noise generated. Hence, the acoustics in a cinema are more sensitive and more attention is to be paid there. So each building facility is different and each has to be studied and researched by an acoustic engineer. So after the acoustic engineer has studied the facility in its design stage, it is generally studied on a model because the facility is not physically built yet. So a model on a computer generated model is used to understand what kind of acoustics will create a comfortable environment. So this acoustic report is generated by an acoustic consultant or an acoustic engineer. Apart from that, in the UAE and in other in most other countries as well, there are regulatory bodies that offer guidance on how the noise can be controlled in different facilities. So in Dubai, for example, I've taken Dubai as an example. Most regions like Ras Al-Khaimah and Sharjah, they sometimes even Abu Dhabi, they follow the same guidelines that Dubai has put forward in Al-Safat document. Al-Safat Green Building Regulations is a document you can download off the website, and there is a section on acoustic comfort, acoustical control. In this section, what you will find that for each different building type, whether you're working on a residential, healthcare, and educational facility, what kind of regulatory documents you can access in order to understand the acoustics required for that facility. So if you're working on a residential facility, then approved document E is the guideline document that is used by most of the acoustic engineers, by most of the architects, consultants, civil engineers, in order to understand what would be the optimum level of acoustics. For healthcare, it's the HDM 0801, and educational facilities, BB93 document. These documents are actually UK guideline documents. They have been used in the United Kingdom for the past a lot of decades. So they are tried and tested. And in Dubai, the noise control section of the Green Building is also recommending these documents. So this is one document that the construction industry bases their acoustics on. What this document is talking about is basically sound insulation between two areas and sound absorption. So there are two different terminologies. We will look into what is the difference between the two terminologies. So there is a figure on the bottom right corner, which is showing that the separating barrier or a wall between two rooms should provide optimum level of sound transmission. So this is called sound insulation or sound transmission. The noise traveling from one area to another separated by a building element is called sound insulation or sound barrier. This could be between one floor to another. Can you see my mouse being indicating on the image, or it's not visible?
Yeah, it's visible, Hiba. Yes. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. So the sound transmission from one area to another between two rooms that are adjacent or between one floor to another. So the floor at the bottom to the floor above is being separated by a building element. So basically these building elements should be designed in a way that they meet the required acoustic sound transmission or sound insulation in order to achieve the optimum acoustic performance required by the acoustic engineer or the regulatory body. So that's what sound insulation means. Sound absorption is if you look at the image on the right, which is a room filled with people. Now these people, as they're talking, they're speaking, they're generating a lot of noise, which is likely to cause a lot of echo within the room. So this echo is going to have impact on speech clarity. So if you imagine like a conference room where you have a stage, you may have noticed whenever you go to a conference room or to a cinema that there are a lot of soft fabrics that are covering the walls as well as the ceilings. What these soft materials are doing, these soft building materials are made of glass wool insulation. And what these materials are doing, they're absorbing the excess noise. And when they're absorbing the excess noise, they're allowing for the speaker who is speaking in the conference room to be more audible and to be heard correctly. So those are the principles of sound absorption. So these two principles, if they are taken care of, then the facility is more comfortable in terms of acoustics. In Saint-Gobain, we have solutions which provide acoustic comfort. So when we are talking about building elements that form a barrier between the two areas, we have gypsum partitions. So the material we are using here is gypsum. So gypsum has a density, and it has properties that reduce the level of noise passing from one area to another. And it's a section detail. And you can see this yellow material in the middle is a glass wool. So gypsum and glass wool are two materials that that don't allow the sound to transmit from one area to another. There are different configurations in terms of the density, the thickness of the board, the number of layers of the board. Different configurations of this assembly can provide with different sound transmissions. So like I said, if you're designing for a guest room between hotel, or if you're designing for a cinema, it's going to have an impact on the assembly of this particular partition. So we'll have to keep that in mind when we are designing for it. Similarly, for ceilings that impact the floor-to-floor transmission, again, it has to be taken care of what value the acoustic engineer wants to achieve. Glass is also not a very good material for sound transmission, but it can work okay if we put it in a form of a specific assembly. So that's why multiple layers of glass are used into a double glazed unit in order to achieve a higher acoustic performance. These are just some reports and calculations I've put on the screen for glass that can help help in providing the required acoustic performance. We usually give this document as a report to the acoustic engineer so that they know what values are being claimed. A lot of design aspects, along with the building material, a lot of design and installation aspects are also required to be taken care of. So basically, the entire pathway of sound is studied in order to detail the junctions and details properly. So over here, we are just going a little bit deeper into the details that how we can ensure that there are no sound leakages. But I'll not spend much time on this section. For reducing the echo and ensuring that the sound is not the speech is clear in a particular area, we have sound absorption materials. So what you see here in these images is not gypsum. Gypsum is a hard material. The material shown in these pictures is a glass fiber insulation which is painted white. So because it's an insulation, it's a soft material. A soft material is always good to absorb the excess noise and produce less echo. So this material is used in areas where high noise generation is expected, like for example, cafeterias that you see on the right, or common areas in an office that you see on the left. You can also achieve sound absorption using perforated gypsum. So basically the perforations in the gypsum allow for the sound to travel through the perforation, and above the ceiling there is an insulation. So above the ceiling there is a soft material. The sound is supposed to travel through these perforations or holes. When the sound travels through these holes, it gets absorbed by the insulation above, which reduces the noise within an area. So that's the principle of this particular building material, such as gypsum, which is hard. You will also see that there are metal perforated ceilings. Metal perforations is something similar. As you know, metal, just like metal and gypsum are both hard materials, they will not absorb the sound. So they are always perforated or they have holes. These holes allow the noise to travel through them and then get absorbed by an absorptive material above the holes. So that was for the acoustic section. And now fire and life safety is another important design aspect or aspect that building materials should comply to in order to ensure fire and life safety of the people using the facility. So we have already taken care of the comfort of the end users in terms of acoustics. And now we want to ensure that if there is a fire, it is not spread easily and it is not blocking the escape routes in order for the people in the facility to escape the fire easily. So similar to acoustics, even for fire and life safety, the regulatory body has a fire and life safety code of practice, which is a very thick book which provides on all the regulations, guidelines, international standards that building materials are required to comply to in order to be used in any building of UAE. Then we have fire and life safety consultants. So these are fire life engineers, again, who are working in this field in order to study the reaction of building materials to fire. So some building materials are combustible, some are non-combustible, some are semi-combustible. So a fire life safety engineer basically studies all the different types of materials that are being used in order to determine how best these materials can be utilized so that they do not negatively impact the fire, so that they don't enhance the fire. They put all of their studies in a fire and life safety report for an individual building. So every individual building has a fire and life safety report. So what the basic job of a fire and life safety engineer would be, in order to study how to create escape routes. So in case there is a fire, the tenants will be required to escape the building. So a fire and life safety consultant will generate a report ensuring that the corridors, specifically corridors, are the escape routes. They are the areas where the people are likely to escape from. So these areas should be having building materials that are highly resistant to fire in order to ensure that they keep standing and they do not get damaged as the public is using the corridors to escape the facility. So there are two kinds of tests that the fire engineer looks into. It's a fire resisting construction and fire reaction tests. We will look into the difference between the both of these. So fire resistance, basically fire resistance is testing if the building material will be structurally stable when there is a fire. So for example, in a corridor, the walls that you have in the corridor and the door assemblies that you have, the windows that you have in the corridor should not fall apart immediately when there is a fire. They should be able to resist the fire up to 60 minutes, 120 minutes if there is a fire. So this is an important performance required of the building materials. There are different testing bodies within the UAE, like Thomas Billwright, Intertech, which have in these laboratories, the entire building construction assembly, like the wall or the door or the window, which are forming a part of the corridor, are tested in this facility. In an actual facility, there's actually a fire in one enclosed area. And this fire is, assembly is tested on how it is reacting to the fire. So main requirements of fire resistance test is to ensure that this assembly does not get structurally damaged. It does not emit, it does not allow fire to move to the other room. Then there are reaction to fire tests also conducted in the same laboratories, Thomas Billwright, Intertech, where a building material is tested to know how fast it will ignite, how fast it will combust. Will it allow the flame to spread through it easily? So as you know, there are some materials, for example, there is nylon, there is plastic. Immediately when you light them, when you light fire, they will immediately spread the fire very fast. So such materials, generally people want to avoid using them, at least in an open area where the fire is likely, to, in an open internal building area where the fire is likely to be produced. And then we don't want material that will ignite very easily and combust and allow the flames to spread. In these terms, gypsum and even block wall, you know, the blocks, the hollow blocks that are built to use walls, these are very good materials. That's why they're used in construction industry to used as the barrier between rooms to create barriers. These materials do not ignite very easily. They do not cause the fire to spread very easily as well. So because of these advantages, these materials are considered good in terms of reaction to fire. So each building material has to be studied and tested in order to understand its reaction to fire. In for Saint-Gobain, we have glass and gypsum partitions as fire resistive assemblies that form barriers, also ceilings, but these are the components, building material components that we have. So what we do is we test the building material in fire life safety laboratory, like Thomas Billwright or Intertech. They give us a certificate claiming that we are, you know, meeting the required standards in order to meet the fire resistive and fire reaction characteristics. Once we get the certificate, Dubai Civil Defense, Abu Dhabi Civil Defense are given a copy of the certificate. And then they give us their approval. So Dubai Civil Defense, Abu Dhabi Civil Defense, all these organizations have approvals for each construction element, component. And then based on that, we can be used on sites by having this certificate. So similarly, we have this fire safety certificate for ceiling as well. These are just some details. The detailing of fire resistive assemblies is also important because, as you know, that if there are any gaps, any pathways for allow the air to travel between the two areas, if these are not sealed properly, then the fire can pass through the gaps that can happen due to improper installation. So detailing is also very important. So now I will move on to indoor comfort. So as you know that we spend a lot of time indoors now because of the pandemic, we are spending even more time. So it is estimated that on an average, we spend 90% of our time indoors, but now because of the pandemic, I think it's around 99%. So one of the aspects that we should be concerning ourselves with is the indoor air. So there are different research that are done that show that there are harmful substances present in the air that we are breathing in. We don't really know of it at times, but there are the research has shown that there are a lot of harmful substances. Now you may be saying that, no, my house is, I think I'm breathing cleaner air in my house or in my school or in whichever building facility that I'm in. But let's look into what these harmful substances are. So these harmful substances are known as volatile organic compounds, and I've put a list of these in this graph. As you can see on the left side, the graph has shown the amount that these harmful substances are present in outdoor environment and the indoor environment. As you can see, the formaldehyde content is present in a huge amount in the indoor environment, apart from the other volatile organic compounds as well. So where are these volatile organic compounds coming from, you may be asking. So building materials, certain building materials are notorious for having emissions of VOC. Furniture, wood, carpet, paint, varnishes, cleaning products, and cooking products. So all these different things which are a part of our everyday life are emitting these volatile organic compounds that we are breathing in. How is this impacting us? Some people are more sensitive, so they are getting allergies and allergic reactions. Some people get headaches. So sometimes you may notice that if you're spending a lot of time indoors, you start feeling uneasy, you get nauseous, you get headaches. So this could be because of breathing in indoor, harmful indoor air quality, eye irritation. These are just some examples. Some people say that if they have proper ventilation, if they have proper like window, if they open their window, they have proper ventilation, they can get rid of some VOCs. While this is correct, the research has shown even with proper ventilation, sometimes the VOC content is higher in the air. It's not really being impacted by the ventilation. So how can we improve the indoor air quality? We can improve it by controlling it at the source. So if the building material that you're using in your construction, in your building, you have to ensure that it is not emitting a high value of VOC. So all building materials these days, most building materials are being asked to test if they're emitting a volatile organic compound. Proper ventilation, so yes, proper ventilation along with controlling it at the source can help with reducing VOC and cleaning the air. So if some people like to have air filters, different kind of air filters that clean the air, so this is also a good effective method of ensuring that you're reducing the air pollutants. Some of the plaster boards, so basically gypsum is a very useful component in construction. Gypsum can accept some additives within its core, and these additives take in the formaldehyde content and convert it into an inert compound. So there's a chemical reaction happening inside the board. The board on the surface will take the air in. It should have a breathable paint. It will take the air in and convert the formaldehyde content into an inert compound and release it back into the air. So it's not an active system. It's a passive technology that will clean the air. So this is an innovation that is there in building materials. Apart from that, the controlling the source of VOC is important. So all building materials these days are, most of them are being asked to test for their emissions of VOC. So most of most materials that have a high content are adhesives, coatings, solvents, paints, glues. I think this is not, this must not be very surprising, because as soon as you open the paint box, the fumes that come out of it can impact your breathing. So I think you can imagine that that's exactly the formaldehyde content that I'm talking about if it is increasing in the air. But sometimes it's not as like as clear to us. Sometimes we feel we are not breathing in harmful gases, but the research is constantly showing that they are present, and if we spend a longer time indoors, we are likely to be breathing a lot of it. So it's always good to have building materials that have low emitting VOC. There are different testing bodies that can test the VOC content of a building material. There's Dubai Central Laboratory that is also testing for these building materials. So these are just some certificates that are showing that different building materials can be tested. Environmental bodies, sustainability bodies are looking into this. They look into this aspect very it's very crucial for them. So bodies like BREEAM, WELL, Al-Safad guidelines, even SC Dama look into the aspect of POC. Over here, I've just put some images that how VOC can be tested in research and development departments of what are the different instruments that are measuring it. Classrooms are actually, schools and classrooms are actually, UAE government considers these to be the important areas where the VOC should be measured. So Saint-Gobain has taken an initiative to actually measure the VOC in schools and classrooms. So those are the images showing the testing being conducted. Okay, let's move on to hygiene. Mainly in this section, we will look at how we can incorporate the right building materials in facilities where hygiene is one of the principal requirements, like healthcare. In healthcare, people who are infected with different disease or a lot of contamination can occur if hygiene is not taken care of. Some building materials allow to be easily cleaned. Some of them are not very easily cleaned and they may get damaged in the process. So while designing, the civil engineers, the designers, they should be careful of what kind of material is going into these facilities. So there is an international standard, it's a French standard, but it is used internationally. The code is given here, air purification and control in healthcare facilities. Basically, the standard divides a healthcare facility into four different segments, and each segment is segregated based on the risk. So operation theaters, for example, are very high risk, and zone A, which is low risk, are office, admin areas and corridors, where a lot of contamination is not really anticipated, but it is still classified as a low risk area in healthcare. The materials being used in this area should still be complying to a certain standard of hygiene. There are other standards for building materials used in healthcare facilities. For example, kinetic class for particle elimination. This is very important, especially if you look into the situation right now with coronavirus. Kinetic class for particle elimination basically studies how fast the material will repel the, how fast it will basically contamination, how long can it stay on its surface. So a lot of studies are studying that. Some people are saying money can get contaminated more easily and the disease can stay in the money and the note that we are exchanging as cash. Some people are saying plastic can get contaminated for days. So how we get to know about it? We get to know about it through the standard kinetic class for particle elimination. This is the standard that studies how long can contamination stay on a particular surface. There are other standards that are used in healthcare, bacteriological class, mold and moisture resistance, etc. So depending on different zones, different cleaning methods are studied. What kind of cleaning will be done in each of these different areas, whether it is in zone A, just vacuum cleaning, wet wiping. In zone C, for example, there is hydrogen peroxide vapor. Now, all building materials cannot sustain hydrogen peroxide vapor and they may get damaged. So these should not be used in a high-risk facility like hospital. So once we have determined what these areas are and what the cleaning methods are, then we can start choosing the materials. In these slides, I have just given some examples of materials available within Saint-Gobain Group. For example, there is a hygiene ceiling which can be disinfected more easily. And if you're designing for zone B, then what are the building materials you can use? Mostly these building materials for hygiene areas are more robust. They allow for a more robust cleaning on their surface. So for example, in humid areas where disinfection is on regular basis, more robust ceiling, partition, and other building materials that are used should be more robust. Operation theater obviously requires specialized materials to be used, as contamination is highly likely in these areas. So let's move on to moisture management. Moisture management, basically in this section, we'll study how building materials react to moisture. Moisture as in not that they can be used inside a swimming pool, but basically moisture as in, for example, in a toilet area or in a steam room, a spa room, wherever, or in an external, semi-external environment, wherever you're expecting high level of humidity, moisture, temperature, how will the building material react to it? So you can see that due to some improper design and usage of this particular building material, there is mold growing on its surface. So it's a block wall which has been painted, and because there was high humidity, I'm talking about the picture on the leftmost corner. In this picture, you can see mold is growing on its surface. Then in the middle picture, you can again see that there is gypsum and there is mold growing on the surface. Then another problem that has happened due to improper management of moisture is there a tile has delaminated, debonded from its surface, because there's something wrong with the building materials that are used or the application of the building material. Mold can also grow on the floor if the moisture is not managed properly. Then in the middle picture, you can see delamination of floor can occur. So if the floor is not prepared properly, then the floor finish that you will apply on it can delaminate if there is water present. So we need to ensure that we are monitoring the moisture in the floor before applying any floor finish. Then debonding of tiles is another concern that happens due to improper management of moisture. All of these issues can be resolved at the design and the construction stage by using, firstly, proper building materials. Secondly, applying them properly in a proper manner so that we are allowing each component to dry and then install the other component on top of it. So we'll look at it in more further detail. For example, in this detail, it's a section detail. You can see this is a barrier, a partition, and this is the floor. So the floor that you can see in this dotted area is actually cementitious. It is made of screed, which is cementitious, and it's generally wet. And it dries in 4 weeks' time. It's going to dry in 4 weeks' time. That's how much time it's going to take. So it's important to ensure that the screed is dried before you start building a partition onto that screed. If you don't do this in the proper manner, then you're going to have the fungi or the mold growing on the surface of the partition. Similarly, if you're not going to allow for the cementitious screed to dry completely, and you're going to start applying carpet or vinyl flooring, rubber flooring, any tiles, even if you start applying porcelain tiles, they're going to delaminate because there is moisture still present in the screed. So these are some common issues that can happen on site. So apart from that, during design, these are just some common wet areas. I think it's very clear: bathrooms, toilets, kitchens, locker rooms, laundry areas. Five key parameters that a material engineer on site needs to look into is the temperature, hygrometry level, direct contact with water cleaning method, and condensation that is going to occur in that facility in order to determine the right building material that is to be used. Application, like I said, it's important to understand the drying time of each different building material. And these are just some solutions. So we have looked at some problems. So basically, we looked at a problem that there was mold growing. So basically, it has to be painted a surface which is likely to be affected by high humidity. The block wall surface has to be painted with an anti-carbonation paint. The anti-carbonation paint will not allow mold to grow on the surface of this hollow block wall. Similarly, for gypsum, there are some gypsum solutions which have biocides and fungicides added to their core, which do not allow the fungi or the mold to grow on it. So if this was taken care of, then there would not be any mold growth. Similarly, there are vapor barriers. So if you apply a vapor barrier on the floor, then it is not going to impact any floor covering you're going to have on top of the screed. So if this was implemented correctly and if the right building material was used, then this problem would not have occurred. Delamination of tiles is mostly to do with application. For example, if you're applying a tile adhesive is mostly a cementitious paste which you apply on the wall. This paste has a particular drying time. It has a particular time when it will accept the application of tile. This time has to be read off the data sheet of this paste adhesive, and accordingly the tile has to be applied on it. So these application methods are important to avoid any problems of delamination. This is just giving like an isometric drawing of a wet area solution of what are some of the important building materials that are to be used in a wet area to ensure that moisture related problems do not occur. I'll go through, we are quickly coming to the end of the presentation. This is the last section. So in the last section, we have been discussing a lot of things that each building material should be carefully selected for its usage and for the usage of the room where it is being used in order to ensure one thing, in order to ensure that it doesn't get damaged easily. What will happen if it gets damaged? If it gets damaged, then you have to constantly keep maintaining it. And then the maintenance cost of that building is going to increase, which is going to, the client is going to have an impact. They're going to keep paying for it again and again. So most of the building materials we're talking about, apart from acoustics and fire, all the other things you have noticed that we are talking about using robust solutions. So how do engineers study robustness? So basically you understand the usage of that particular room. For example, a basketball court is going to have a very different usage from a guest bedroom in a hotel or a residential apartment, right? Why it is going to be different? Because in a basketball court, you're going to get more impact on the floor. You're going to get more impact on the walls. You're going to need a more rigid construction. You're not going to need that kind of a construction in the hotel guest room. Secondly, it's also high traffic or low traffic. So for example, if you're designing a metro station, you have to design for more robust building materials because you're expecting a lot of crowd to use this space. However, a hotel lounge is not going to expect as many people, and you can reduce the robustness of materials that are used. So some factors that engineers consider: wear and tear from the user, molecular structure, resistance to moisture that we looked into, corrosive substances, resistance to aggressive animal life like vermin, mold growth, ability to accept movement. So for example, basketball court, the floor should have the ability to accept such movement, resistance to atmospheric pressure, resistance to heat and cold, capacity for moisture absorption, and surface profiles, orientation, texture, and color. So surface profiles should also be well adapted to the building need. There are international guidelines and standards like BS standards, British standards, or ASTM standards that study the robustness of materials in order for engineers to understand what is the right material to be used for its application. So for example, I'll take partitions as an example. There is a standard called BS 5234 that studies the stiffness of the partition, that studies the surface damage and perforation. If there is a door in the partition, if you're going to slam that door, is it going to damage the wall? Surface and structural damage, like if large soft body impact. This is basically if a person gets pushed to the wall, is it going to damage the wall? This is generally tested for jails, because in jails you may have some sort of adverse reaction from the users, from the tenants. So these kind of tests are conducted on the wall. And then the wall is divided, each different wall type, depending on its configuration, each wall type is different. It is then segregated into these grades: light, medium, heavy, and severe duty. Severe duty is the highest grade, which is by the standard is recommended to be used in areas prone to vandalism and abnormally rough use. Then heavy duty is like malls, retail, where you're not really expecting abnormal rough use of the wall. So this classification allows the engineers to determine which facility they can use it in. This is just an example of a very high density solution, which is anti-theft and anti-burglar resistance. So this is a very high impact solution that Saint-Gobain is offering. Then even the glass, you have noticed that sometimes the glass breaks easily, sometimes it's laminated, it gives it more strength. So even in glass, there are a lot of innovative types of glass available, like the bullet resistant, attack resistant, vandal resistant, explosion resistant glass that an engineer decides where should it be used depending on the usage of the area. For example, I'll give you an example, like some embassies and consulates like to use an attack resistant glass. Yeah. Because it's a secure facility and they have optimum security requirements. But if you're designing, let's say, for a shop, a general retail shop, you will not need an explosive or attack resistant glass. Even a bullet resistant glass is not required. You will just be going for a normal glass application. So again, this is decided by engineers what kind of glass is going in. Apart from that, the flooring solutions. Now, flooring is different for residential units. For residential hotels, offices, and warehouse, you have same type of floor. So screed is basically referring to floor. But if you have high pedestrian, high traffic areas, like the metro example that we, the railway station example, you'll need something that is well adapted to take that kind of traffic. Even in shopping malls, exhibition, car parks, the floor that you use in car park is different from the one that you use inside a mall, for example, because in a car park, the floor is supposed to take the weight of the car. So some other requirements that an engineer studies for flooring is high chemical resistance. So for example, in healthcare, the chemicals that are being used are harsh, so the floor should be able to sustain it. Anti-skid requirements generally for garages and car parks, and even for factories where you have forklifts, then liquid tightness, high mechanical resistance, decorative. So if you're going for a school or a nursery, you will want something that's decorative. And high requirements on hygiene, for example, the healthcare that we have looked into. So here are just some examples of different applications where the building material for floor, for glass will be different. So production areas, warehouses, workshops, car parks, maybe having a high mechanical strength and anti-skid performing floor. But for hospitals, schools, it's not going to be same because you're only expecting human traffic on these floors. So why are we studying robustness? I think I've already covered that in the beginning. In order to ensure service life estimation, in order to ensure that throughout the life of the building material, it's not going to cause any issues. These issues will result in maintenance. So the client does not want to keep maintaining their facility, so they need to do it in an optimized way. So in order to ensure that robust materials are to be used, time variance, structural reliability, again, it's related to the life cycle of the building material. I'll skip through this section. This is just talking about how important it is for different stakeholders in the construction industry to study the building materials at every stage of construction. Some of the documents that the engineers used in order to use the correct building material is the system selector. So if, for example, you're the engineer working on a project, now you have to select so many different building materials, the flooring, the glass, the partition, the ceilings, and expansion joints. You have a lot of different building materials to study. So at each different building material is also different from its area of usage, right? So in order to ensure that you're choosing the right building material, you need to have access to the right system selector. Mostly these are available with manufacturers. So if Saint-Gobain is a manufacturer, they are providing a system selector to these engineers to ensure that they can select the right system for their application. Then how the information regarding a particular system is conveyed to the engineer, it is in a specification document that you can see in the second picture. It's basically a Word document with a lot of text. I think even in my engineering module in Bolton, I had worked on some of these specifications as part of an assignment. So I think some of you in second or third year might be familiar with this work. Then of course, details, drawings are obviously necessary, BIM models. So of course, you're all aware of AutoCAD Pro engineering softwares that generate these kind of models. Aesthetic section is generally for interior designers and some engineers also look into it, but these are just aspects of how to make the facility more decorative. So there are these building materials, apart from their other performances, their primary performances also to look aesthetic. So I'll just show you some images of these building materials. So these are ceilings that are offering you a decorative element as well as absorbing the sound. And they're also offering you the fire reaction performances. So each building material is being used in this facility, not only for its aesthetic, but also for its acoustic performance, its fire reaction, and all the other things we have looked at. Again, for glass, some glasses are not used for attack resistance, fire resistance. They're used solely for the purpose of decoration. So then there's a selection of these. So I think with this, we have come to an end to our presentation. If at this point, I think it's good to take some question answers. So I'll be happy to know if you have some queries you want to look further into.
Thank you, Hiba. That was a very informative and comprehensive presentation covering all aspects of building operation from acoustics, fire and life safety, indoor air quality, hygiene, even robustness in operation, and also the aesthetics parts. That is very comprehensive. I'm sure the students have had have got a very broad overview of what goes into a building design, and you know how difficult is our task, you know, in designing or working closely with the architects and designers in creating a safe environment and cleaner environment. So we do have some questions from the audience. I'll first take the questions as related to acoustics. So there's a question asking, are perforated materials good for absorption of all frequencies, especially the high frequencies? At the same time, there's also a question that's related to that, to absorb low frequency audio, such as the vibration generated by machines, what sort of materials would you suggest?
Okay, those are some really good questions, Ben. I'm really glad to know these kinds of questions are coming in. Each different ceiling type, which is meant for absorption, you can say any different building material that is primarily being used in a facility for absorption, is studied at different frequencies. So basically, there's a test report for each of these building materials that are studying its sound absorption. When we are studying the sound absorption, basically we are testing the material at different frequencies, what kind of sound it is absorbing. And then we take an average of how it's performing at different frequencies. And that value we claim for that particular building material. So for example, for perforated gypsum, their range of sound absorption is noise reduction coefficient, is NRC value, is what we use to gauge the performance. And the performance of perforated ceilings is generally from 0.5 to 0.9. Yeah, 0.5 to 0.9 is the NRC that is achieved by these perforated gypsum. They are good, but they are not as good as a glass fiber, such as this particular ceiling that I have put on the screen. This particular ceiling is a soft material. It's not gypsum, it's soft insulation painted with the white paint. Since this entire material is soft, it is offering a larger surface area for the sound to be absorbed. However, in a perforated gypsum, only the perforations are allowing the sound to pass and then get absorbed by the absorptive material. Hence, it is good, but not as good as an entirely soft material. So one NRC, 0.9 or one NRC can be achieved by these particular ceilings because they are covering a larger range of frequencies, support and larger frequencies, and because of their larger surface area to absorb the sound.
Yeah, thank you, Hiba. I think that was quite clear and to the point. I think we have also questions related to how do you find a balance between fire resistance and also soundproofing. So like if foam insulation, a good practice for fire resistant material and or a medium for fire resistance. And also we have a question, is sound insulating materials flammable or not? So like kind of what's the balance between soundproofing and also flammability property?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's again a good question. Now, foams are used in some industries. They are used in some industries mainly for their thermal efficiency as well. So they are used in an external envelope of the building. And they are used to ensure that if we are trying to keep the room inside cold, then this should not be lost to the outside atmosphere, and hence foams are sometimes used in the external envelope of the building. So one of the tests that is absolutely required for these foams is the fire reaction, fire resistant test. The primary performance why the foam is required is the thermal efficiency. I'm talking about the external envelope. But in the UAE, for example, if you want to use this foam, it has to pass the reaction and fire resistive tests, which is why to date, foams are not very commonly used in UAE. In other parts, they are being used because more innovative types of foams are available that are also providing fire performance. But in the UAE, they're using stone wool insulation. Stone wool is is very good when it comes to fire resistance and fire reaction. So stone wool is actually a wool that has stones embedded in it. And overall, its performance does not increase the spread of fire. It, in fact, decreases the spread of fire, which is why stone wool at the moment is being used in applications for thermal efficiency, because it's very good for fire as well. So this is where the engineers decide what is the optimum product or building material that they need to use. Apart from the acoustic performance, if that's the primary performance you want to use the building material for, it has to also complement the fire performance. Otherwise, people don't consider it as useful because they don't want to impact fire and life safety performance. In general, there are a lot of building materials available that give you both fire as well as acoustics, such as the one that we have on the screen.
Thank you. I think we have something related to volatile organic compounds. So what do you think of precast concrete material or panels to reduce the volatile organic compound for the outdoor areas as well as the classrooms? Mm-hmm. And one more question related to volatile organic compounds. What is your take on passive ventilation system with regards to volatile organic compounds in air? And as nowadays sustainable options, is it having significance?
Okay, so
you can answer it as two separate questions also.
Okay, so your first question is the precast concrete, how it is impacting the VOC. And can you repeat the second question?
The second question is about passive ventilation system with regards to VOC in air.
VOC in air, okay. Now in general, like when we talk about indoor air quality and how can we improve the indoor air quality, generally end users like yourself or like me, what we look into is getting an air filtering system. So this is an active system which requires electricity, and then it will start filtering or cleaning your air. Yeah. So this is one way of cleaning the air, which is an active system. Generally, the building materials that are used and selected by engineers, they are not meant to clean the air. Generally, what a building material engineer should be careful of is that the building material is not emitting VOC. That's generally in most scenarios, building material selection engineers concern themselves with selecting the right building material that is not emitting a lot of formaldehyde. Like if they're using a paint, if they're using precast concrete insulation, whatever building material they're using should not be emitting a lot of VOC. That's all that's required at the design stage. Generally, solutions like precast concrete, they have no impact on the VOC. Like a precast concrete, unless it is painted, it will not be emitting a lot of VOC. The VOC emission of precast concrete is very low. On the other hand, it will not be filtering the system as well. This is just one technology that Saint-Gobain has innovated, where the gypsum board, in a normal scenario, a gypsum board will not clean the air. It will not remove the formaldehyde content. A normal gypsum board will not do that. However, there's an active air technology. It's an innovative technology developed by Saint-Gobain, in which this additive is added to the recipe of the gypsum board. This additive will convert formaldehyde compound into an inert compound and hence act as a passive technology. Like a passive technology is something like this gypsum board, which you can use as a ceiling, and you don't have to pay anything. You don't have to use any electricity. You don't have to concern yourself with this board. This board automatically on its own will keep, like, you know, keep converting the VOC to inert compound. So that's mainly what passive technology will do. Generally building materials don't have such additives. The only thing the building material engineer concerns with is the emission from the building material.
We have another question which is related to air conditioning. Since we are living in a hot and humid region, which constantly requires the usage of air conditioning, it is required to sustain the internal temperature and to separate the cold air from hot air emitted from AAC. So what is the material you would use for it and how many layers would be required?
Okay, so basically I think this question is more related to thermal efficiency. Now, yes. Thermal efficiency is one of the comforts that we generally discussed when we are talking about the external envelope of the building. Because the maximum chances that you have of like the thermal efficiency to be damaged or affected is by the external envelope. So for example, if you're going to have an external wall, and if you're going to have more windows, if you're going to have entire glass facade, then it's going to have a higher impact on your thermal efficiency. However, if you're just looking at, so building materials for external walls or external envelopes are carefully designed to meet a particular thermal efficiency value. But internally, if you're talking about room to room, for example, if I'm switching on AC in one room and I don't want the cold air to be lost to the other room, then most of the internal building materials like precast concrete, hollow block, gypsum walls, all these have very low conductivity. That's why it's not, I mean, mostly people don't study it, because building materials that are generally used have very low thermal conductivity. They do not have an impact that the air is lost, the thermal efficiency is affected between two rooms. The only area people should be careful about is ceiling. Even whenever you're having an MEP detail, if you're having any sort of MEP detailing done onto your separating element or a partition separating the two rooms, it should not have air leakages or air gaps to allow for the thermal efficiency to be affected.
So I think we've already, gone past the time. I think I'll wind up with one last question. So it's about the end of life. So initially we spoke about how circularity in operation is an importance, how that is also becoming a priority. So during the design phase, is there a choice of keeping this in the aim or the objective of construction, that there should be a circularity in operation, especially in terms of construction waste being handled? And at the same time, how do you measure the aging of the building material, or what is the scale to measure whether it has reached the end of the life cycle? With that, I think we can wind up today's question answer session.
Okay, great. That's also a very good question, Ben. And yes, during the early design stage, if the architect wants to study the life cycle of the building material, there are some manufacturers who are providing the EPD certificate. It's called Environmental Product Declaration Form. This basically is a certification by a third party that studies the entire life cycle of the building material, from the time it is a raw material to its manufacturing, logistics, installation. And this report helps the designers to know exactly how it is going to impact the environment. However, this EPD certificate is not very old. It's very new. Just 2-3 years back, LEED, the Green Environmental Body LEED, started actually in order to achieve like a platinum or gold LEED certification, you require the EPD certificate. So just 2 to 3 years back, this started becoming common and manufacturers started to have more EPDs in order to study the impact of the building material throughout its life cycle. In the past, it was not studied in that much detail. I think your next question was, how do we know the deterioration of the building material? Generally, in construction, all the building materials are designed for 25 years of service life. 25 years, you can use that material. And the warranty is given for the material for 5 to 10 years. 5 to 10 years warranty is given and 25 years of life cycle is estimated. However, there are, of course, maintenance procedures to enhance the life of the building material. But in general, as the basic principle, all building materials for their application after studying their robustness are designed for 25 to 30 years of application.
Thank you so much, Hiba. That is a very comprehensive presentation and also detailed question answer session. I now hand over to Aisha to give a vote of thanks and conclude today's session.
Sure. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
I take this opportunity to extend our heartfelt gratitude to our guest speaker for the day, Ms. Hiba Aijaz, for the wonderful presentation. This was very inspiring and informative. I also would like to thank University of Bolton, the professional body organizer, for conducting an informative session for us students. Last but not the least, I thank all faculty members, students from various departments who have attended today's session and made the first session of University of Bolton Rock webinar series a great success. Looking forward to your participation and cooperation in the upcoming session as well. Thank you and have a good day.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you.